Recorded Books presents An American Martyr in Persia, The Epic Life and Tragic Death of Howard Baskerville by Reza Aslan, narrated by the author. This book is dedicated to everyone everywhere fighting for their rights. Persia much regrets the honorable loss of your dear son in the cause of liberty, and we give our parole that future Persia will always preserve his name in her history, like that of Lafayette in America, and will respect his venerable tomb. Cablegram concerning the death of Howard Cochran Baskerville, sent to his father Henry by the revolutionary commander Sattar Khan, April 1909. Introduction. I have always known the name Howard Baskerville. For as long as I can remember, his name was a flash in the corner of my eye. When I was a child growing up in Iran, there were schools named after him. His face, cast in bronze, was prominently displayed in a museum in Tabriz, the city in which he died and was buried. His tomb is still there, pressed up against an overgrown apricot tree in a long abandoned cemetery. The edges of the sarcophagus are smooth and worn, not from the elements, but from a century or so of curious hands. People used to come here from all over the country to honor the American who gave his life for Iran. These days, hardly anyone comes at all. Those few who still visit his tomb know little about the man lying inside, save for the bare facts of his life and death. He was 22 years old, a Christian missionary. He came to Persia in the fall of 1907 to teach English and history, and to preach the gospel. Although Iranians referred to the country as Iran, it would not officially be known as Iran until 1935. He took up arms and fought alongside his students in a bloody revolution against a ruthless tyrant. He died a martyr in the cause of freedom and democracy. That is pretty much all I knew about Howard Baskerville. To Iranians of my generation, he was simply the American. The name embodied the country. It was a metonym for the United States. Youthful, impassioned, a little bit naive perhaps, but earnest in the conviction that freedom is inalienable. In the run-up to the Iranian Revolution of 1979, the third of three revolutions in my home country over the course of the 20th century, Baskerville's name surfaced once again. There was an expectation among some Iranians that America, quote, a nation of Baskervilles, would undoubtedly support the struggle against a dictator that many deemed to be as vile and repressive as the one Baskerville died fighting against 70 years earlier. That would not be the case, of course. America was more concerned with promoting its interests than its principles in Iran. If Mr. Baskerville were resurrected today and still intent on fighting dictators and oppressors, wrote a prominent Persian writer and activist in 1977, he would find himself shooting his own countrymen. The metonym, it seemed, had broken. Afterward, when the American-backed Shah fled to the United States and the Persian monarchy transformed into an Islamic republic, a different form of tyranny, Baskerville's story was wiped from the country's collective memory. The schools were renamed, the bronze bust tucked into a corner of the museum. His tomb was abandoned, his name forgotten, his self-sacrifice buried beneath decades of anger and animosity between the United States and Iran. I, too, eventually forgot his name. As an Iranian refugee living in America, I could have made Baskerville my lodestar, my guide and beacon in an unfamiliar country I was suddenly forced to call home. But no American had ever heard of him. He wasn't taught in schools or talked about in politics. In Iran, Baskerville had been erased from our history books. In America, he was never in them to begin with. Over the years, I found myself occasionally looking for Howard Baskerville again. I would pore over what little I could find in archives and libraries, trying to piece together a meaningful account of his life and death. I found historical documents casting him as a pure-hearted youth, whose blood came to a boil at the sight of the suffering that took place around him. And I read opinion pieces, painting him as a reckless white savior whose insertion into Persian affairs presaged a century of American interference in Iran. Some called him a hero, the American Lafayette. Marquis de Lafayette was a French military officer who fought in the American Revolutionary War. Others viewed him as naive and easily manipulated into giving his life for a country that wasn't his, a people he barely knew, a cause he hardly understood. The U.S. government at the time labeled him a traitor and threatened him with imprisonment or worse if he did not desist his revolutionary activities and return to America at once. The Presbyterian Church, which had sent Baskerville to Tabriz to convert the population, disavowed him altogether. He wasn't one of theirs, they claimed. Not really. Yet nothing I read adequately explained how this pious young man from the Black Hills of South Dakota wound up fighting a revolution in turn-of-the-century Persia. It's as though he spent the first 20 years of his life walking a path beaten by generations of Baskervilles before him, including his father and grandfather, his uncle and brother, a path that led directly to the pulpit. And then, for reasons that aren't exactly clear, he suddenly swerved off the path and strode headlong into the wilderness. It was only in the process of writing this book, the first biography ever written about the young man, that my eyes were finally opened as to who Howard Baskerville truly was, what led him to abandon everything he knew to fight for Persia, and what his death a century ago could mean for all of us today. I wrote this book because I believe every American and every Iranian should know the name Howard Baskerville, and that name should be a reminder of all the two peoples hold in common. My hope is that his heroic life and death can serve in both countries as the model for a future relationship, one based not on mutual animosity, but on mutual respect. Perhaps then, America can once more be known as a nation of Baskervilles. Part 1. A student without devotion is a lover without money. A traveler without knowledge is a bird without wings. A scholar without action is a tree without fruit. And a devotee without learning is a house without a door. Saadi. Chapter 1. The Mohammedan Work. Howard Baskerville exits the Presbyterian Board of Foreign Missions building on the northwest corner of 5th Avenue and 20th Street in New York City, a one-way ticket on a steamship bound for Europe tucked into his jacket pocket. He drags a small second-hand steamer trunk packed with a Bible, some books, Thackeray, Dickens, and a few items of clothing. The one first-class outfit he owns he purchased specifically for this trip. He will need a fine suit for preaching. But I like to picture him wearing it on this steamy midsummer morning, perhaps in August or late July. It isn't clear. He'd want to look his best for his final meeting with the General Secretary of the Missions Board, the esteemed Robert E. Speer. It's not that Baskerville thought Speer might change his mind about dispatching him overseas. He had more than demonstrated the strong Christian character and true missionary spirit the board expected of those it sent into the field. But after the suffocatingly slow train ride from his family's home in South Dakota, it would have felt good to be clean and proper again, dressed in a white waistcoat and striped tie, a stiff bowler hat perched at an angle on his head. Even at this early hour, the city would be bustling with activity, horse-drawn carriages and lumbering trolleys vying for space with the odd motor car on the broken cobblestone streets. It is the twilight of the Gilded Age in America, though, in truth, the gilt peeled off long ago. In a few short years, the Great War will lay waste to most everything east of the Atlantic. But on this side of the ocean, war will mean more factories, more shipyards, more coal and steel, and thus more riches for the handful of robber barons who control it all. From where Baskerville stands on that busy street corner, he could lift his head and see towers scraping the sky. On the streets below, stoop-shouldered men, wailing children, cold, unlit tenements. I doubt the meager travel allowance Baskerville received from the Presbyterian Church would allow for a carriage ride to the docks, and anyway, why deny the ambience of a stroll through the city? Pushcarts piled with fruit as pale as the women selling them, workmen in knee-high boots sweeping horseshit off the streets, blank-faced children shucking oysters on the curb. The stench would only get worse as Baskerville turns down 14th Street and walks past the blood-splattered butcher shops of the meatpacking district. That's when the docks come into view. In 1907, New York Harbor is the busiest port in the world. Stretched along its craggy shore are dozens of double-decked piers crowded with workers unloading cargo, merchants selling their wares, and thousands upon thousands of newly arrived immigrants, mostly Italians, Poles, and Yiddish-speaking Jews, carrying their entire lives in sacks flung over their shoulders. They came here crammed in the bowels of ships. Steerage class, they called it. Men, women, and children packed into small, lightless compartments, sleeping in beds stacked one above the other, eating gruel dished out of copper kettles, all for the chance to build Rockefeller's railroads and Vanderbilt's ships. New York is as far as many of them will go. Nearly three-quarters of the city's population are either newly arrived or the children of immigrants. Some never even leave the docks. There is plenty of work to do on the piers, helping passengers like Baskerville board the very same ships they took on their long voyage here. There is no shortage of ships. The gray waters of the Hudson are choked with hulking ocean liners and state-of-the-art steamships, their engines belching smoke across the harbor. Stiff competition among American, British, and European shipping companies over who can best cater to the needs of the well-heeled traveler has led to a dizzying array of innovations meant to make the journey across the Atlantic safer, faster, and far more extravagant. First-class passengers can expect private commodes wrapped in marble, wood-paneled dining rooms capped with glass-domed ceilings, smoking rooms designed to resemble Italian palazzi, and dining bars that look like French chateaux. The German liner SS America features the world's first a la carte restaurant at sea, called the Ritz-Carlton, allowing passengers to dine whenever they wish, instead of during rigidly set mealtimes. On RMS Adriatic, recently launched by the Liverpool-based White Star Line, the shipping company that would gain infamy in a few years with the sinking of the pride of its fleet, RMS Titanic, one can relax in a Turkish bath, play squash below decks in the ship's gleaming gymnasium, or take a dip in the world's first floating swimming pool. The colossal sister ships of the Cunard line, RMS Lusitania and RMS Mauritania, both of which would dwarf anything else floating in the harbor, boast never-before-seen turbine steam engines, making them the fastest passenger ships in the world. The Mauritania, at the time the largest moving structure ever built, can cross the Atlantic in a record-setting 4.5 days, thanks to the back-breaking work of the boiler room crew. With the outbreak of the Great War, some of these vessels will be seized by their nations and outfitted as troop carriers or hospital ships. Shipping lanes will be cluttered with naval mines and patrolled by German U-boats. One of them sank the Lusitania in 1915. And passenger ports will be repurposed as pickup points for soldiers heading to the front. But war is still 7 years away. For now, a steady parade of fully laden ships continues to steam west to the New World, their bellies bursting with emigrants huddled inside closed berth cabins, eating rancid food, breathing rancid air, and then east back toward Europe, their main decks flecked with top hats and parasols. Baskerville, of course, will experience neither the luxuries of first class nor the inhumanity of steerage. In 1907, a trip from New York to Liverpool could cost anywhere between $50 and $80. On the Mauritania, a first class ticket could cost as much as $150. That's nearly $4,000 in today's prices. But Baskerville could still grab a third class seat on any one of these ships for about $20. No sense, then, looking for him in an oak-lined dining bar constructed from Palestinian wood and littered with plush leather chairs. He'll be taking his evening drinks in a dimly lit cafeteria, standing at a metal-topped communal table. It's hard to imagine the luxuries available to first-class passengers would have mattered much to a pastor's son from South Dakota. After all, Howard Baskerville isn't some new-moneyed traveler eager to consume the riches of the old world. He's a 22-year-old Christian missionary, en route to the far-flung lands of Persia for a 2-year mission in pursuit of what he termed the Mohammedan work, that is, the conversion of Muslims to Christ. Howard Conklin Baskerville was born in North Platte, Nebraska, on April 13, 1885, the son and grandson of Presbyterian preachers. His father, Henry Coleman Baskerville, was a peripatetic pastor and lifelong seeker of knowledge, who had made his public confession of faith at the age of 16, while kneeling in an old clabbered box of a church in Nutbush, North Carolina. The elder Baskerville went on to study Christian ministry at Davidson College and the University of Virginia before graduating from the University of Georgia in 1867. 2 years at Virginia's Union Seminary resulted in his ordination by the Presbyterian Church, though rather than go immediately into full-time ministry, he chose instead to pursue a law degree, ultimately being admitted to the bar in Baltimore in 1876. There is no evidence that Henry Baskerville actually practiced law, either in Baltimore or anywhere else for that matter. In 1879, his first wife, Julia Blanton, died unexpectedly, leaving him to raise their daughter on his own. He wouldn't remain a bachelor for long. A year later, he married Emma Reed in a small private ceremony in Plattsburgh, New York. Together, they would have one more daughter and then four sons, one after the other. Howard was the second-born son. In 1883, the family settled in Nebraska, where Henry Baskerville was assigned various preaching positions in small Presbyterian churches across the state. When Howard was 5 years old, his father moved the family from Nebraska to New Jersey so he could pursue yet another degree, this one from Princeton Theological Seminary, where he would ultimately receive a Bachelor of Divinity in 1897. Over the next few years, even as he was completing a PhD from Worcester University in Ohio, Henry would bounce from one church assignment to another. First in Spring Mills, Pennsylvania, then Goods Ferry, Virginia, then back to Princeton for a brief stint teaching, then in Alzada, Montana, and Camp Crook, South Dakota, before finally being named lead pastor of the Presbyterian churches in Spearfish Valley, on the northern edge of the Black Hills, in 1901. Although Howard would spend only a few years in Spearfish before leaving for college, the Black Hills and Badlands of South Dakota, with their broad prairies, spectacular buttes, and seemingly bottomless gorges, bore into his soul a deep and abiding love for the outdoors. The area had only recently been opened to white settlement. The entirety of the Black Hills region was designated by the U.S. government as the permanent home of the Lakota tribe in the 1868 Treaty of Fort Laramie. 6 years later, however, after General George Custer discovered gold in these hills, the U.S. government tore up the treaty and took the land back, herding the Lakota into sparse reservations scattered across the barren lands of western South Dakota. Amidst the brightly colored spires and wind-ravaged pinnacles that ringed this natural wonderland, Baskerville matured into an adventurous young man, in the mold of the naturalist Rough Rider, who was then president of the United States, and whose face would soon be carved into a mountain just a few miles south of here. Actually, with his brown hair, blue eyes, and rosy cheeks, the bespectacled Baskerville bore a faint resemblance to the young Teddy Roosevelt, minus the ever-present mustache. He could hike across the prairie grasslands all the way up to Bear Butte Mountain, the path marked with prayer cloths tied to tree branches by the expelled tribe for whom this mount was sacred. He could hunt pheasant or grouse, or perhaps try his luck picking off one of the countless black-tailed prairie dogs whose burrows made these wide-open plains look like a veritable moonscape. He could explore the river-carved canyons or go fishing in the cold waters of Spearfish Creek, which was fed year-round with trout eggs hauled by covered wagon all the way from Yellowstone. His favorite pastime, however, was riding horses. During his summer vacations, he occasionally worked at a nearby horse ranch, where in exchange for feeding and caring for the animals, he would have the opportunity to ride across the endless pastures of South Dakota, racing alongside wild buffalo, skirting the edge of the surrounding granite cliffs. Baskerville also loved to box and play tennis, both of which were more salutary to pursue in the desert climate of the Black Hills region, where the dry air eased the chronic catarrh from which he suffered all his life, the result of a bout of malaria he contracted as a child. Like his father, Baskerville was a bookish young man with a thirst for knowledge and a talent for picking up languages. By the time he graduated high school, he was fluent in Latin, Greek, and German. But unlike his father, Baskerville never seemed to have expressed much interest in becoming a country pastor. He wanted to spread the word of Christ to all peoples in all nations. Ever since he was a child, he had thought about becoming a missionary, with more or less definitiveness, he wrote in his application to the Presbyterian Board of Foreign Missions. He had taken mission study courses through his church and served as president of the local chapter of the Young People's Society of Christian Endeavor, an evangelical organization that, at the time, boasted 3.5 million members in countries as far afield as China and Australia. He was even put in charge of his own mission field by the Black Hills Presbytery, during which he claimed to have, quote, spoken with a number of persons about this Christian life, though with what success he was too modest to say in his application. When it was time to decide on a college, memories of the year he spent with his father at Princeton returned to his mind. And so Howard followed in Henry's footsteps, applying to Princeton University for a degree in Christian ministry. It was the fall of 1903, an auspicious time for Princeton, which was still roiling from a seismic shift in the school's program and priorities. Only a year earlier, the Board of Trustees had promoted one of its more popular professors, Woodrow Wilson, to be president of the university, and he had wasted little time in remodeling the school in his own image. Young Howard was immediately drawn into Wilson's orbit. It would have been difficult to miss the tall, thin man in the starched white collar dashing back and forth across the quad, the rubber tip of his walking cane hovering always a few inches off the ground. Wilson's face, once you glimpsed it, was unforgettable, an almost perfect rectangle framed by a high, flat forehead and an aggressive jaw that jutted out like an admonition. As a professor, Wilson had a famously low tolerance for fools. He was severely critical of Princeton's student body and battled publicly and frequently with both the faculty and the administration. Yet his students adored him. 7 times he was voted Princeton's favorite professor. He routinely filled 300-seat lecture halls, often with students from other classes crowding the hallways, straining to hear his stirring orations about the greatness of American democracy and the need for American leadership abroad. The coiffed and preened Princeton men would lean forward in their seats, notebooks open, as Wilson thrilled them with grand proclamations such as, "The progress of civilization has obliterated the frontier," or "The nation has broken its shell." They would stamp their feet and rise in applause. Even in informal settings, Wilson spoke with ecclesiastical authority, as though he were reading from a script. It was an oratory skill bred into him at a very young age. His father, Joseph Wilson, a fire and brimstone Presbyterian preacher, would often force him to memorize the speeches of great men, and then not just recite them on command, but improve upon them. As a child, Wilson practiced giving rousing sermons to empty pews, the expectation being that he would follow his father into the Presbyterian ministry. That is likely why he himself enrolled as a student at Princeton, then known as the College of New Jersey. Princeton was a school founded by Presbyterians, and its chief function in those days seemed to be to churn out a bevy of black-robed ministers to replenish America's pulpits. Nearly a quarter of Wilson's graduating class would go on to become men of the cloth. But, as with Baskerville, the pulpit never held much interest for Woodrow Wilson. His passion was politics. Wilson entered Princeton as a freshman in 1879, 14 years after the end of the Civil War. The war had a deep impact on the Wilson family, which fully identified with the Confederacy. Wilson's father was a slaveholder and fervent supporter of the Confederate cause, even after the war's end. A family photo taken in 1892, nearly 3 decades after emancipation, depicts the Wilsons smiling and seated together in front of their doorstep in South Carolina. 2 elderly black servants in matching white cotton dresses stand at attention behind them, staring uneasily off camera. As a child, Woodrow Wilson idolized the Confederate General Robert E. Lee. His classmates recall him always taking the Southern side in debates, and he was never happier than when he was debating. At Princeton, he was a star member of one of the legendary debating clubs, the Whigs and the Clios. Wilson, emulating one of his political heroes, James Madison, joined the Whigs. Yet, when at a prestigious end-of-year debate in 1879, he was randomly chosen to argue the side of universal suffrage, Wilson threw a fit and stormed off the stage, rather than be forced to argue for the right of black Americans to vote. Indeed, one cannot speak about any stage of Woodrow Wilson's storied career without acknowledging his unrepentant racism. He was, in the judgment of the black actor and activist Paul Robeson, an advocate for democracy for the world and Jim Crow for America. As a professor, Wilson regaled his students with an endless supply of racist jokes about rustic Negroes. In his writings, he lavished praise on the Ku Klux Klan, calling it a veritable empire of the South, whose role in protecting the Southern country should be enshrined. As president of Princeton University from 1902 to 1910, he refused to follow the lead of other Ivy League schools and allow admission to black students, arguing that their presence would, quote, be embarrassing for them and for Princeton University. As president of the United States, he made segregation official government policy, firing black federal workers and reversing decades of racial progress. He even screened Birth of a Nation at the White House. Wilson could speak with biblical certainty about the inviolability of God-given freedoms. He could, in his speeches, elevate human liberty to a moral prerogative. He could preach universal sympathy for those who struggle and claim, without irony, to seek to lift the unbearable burdens that were upon their backs. He just didn't mean the backs of black people. Still, if you were a young white man of privilege like Howard Baskerville, Wilson was your paladin. In 1902, Woodrow Wilson was promoted from professor of politics to president of the university. In that role, he helped enact an educational revolution whose reverberations are to this day felt by nearly all university students in the United States. He reorganized Princeton's academic departments, enforced higher educational standards for graduates, and reformed the school curriculum to better match the needs of a rapidly changing, increasingly interconnected world. He instituted an Oxford-style mentoring program, known as the preceptorial system, the purpose of which was to shepherd students out of Princeton's high-ceilinged halls and into a more intimate setting where they could receive personal one-on-one instruction from their chosen professor. More broadly, he redirected undergraduate education away from its focus on specialized fields and toward general training, or as Wilson put it, a familiarity with principles, rather than the acquisition of, imperfect at best, a mass of miscellaneous information. This included overhauling Princeton's electives system in a bid to encourage students to stretch their minds by taking courses outside of their chosen fields. Wilson's goal was not merely to transform higher education in America. It was to transform university students from cloistered scholars to global citizens, to make of them an army of righteous young men primed for national service. The reforms caused a stir among Princeton's old guard, the alumni, and wealthy donors. But it brought Wilson national notoriety, paving the way for his eventual entrance into politics, first as governor of New Jersey, and then as president of the United States. Once in the White House, Woodrow Wilson would expand his vision of a student body in service to the nation into a policy of a nation in service to the world. He was inaugurated in 1913, a year before the outbreak of the First World War, and while he managed to keep the United States out of that conflict during his first term, by 1917, thousands of American troops were marching into Europe to fight alongside the Allied powers. For better or worse, the Great War forced America out of its isolation, and in its aftermath, Wilson sought to inject what he viewed as America's universal values onto the global stage. In the rubble and ash the war had left behind, Wilson saw an opportunity to rebuild the world in America's image. He envisioned a new world order composed not of detached, isolated countries in perpetual conflict with one another, but of interdependent nations guided by international norms, governed by international law, and safeguarded by international organizations. In this new world order, America would no longer be the city on a hill, a shining beacon of liberty for weary travelers yearning for freedom. Rather, it would be a torchlight shined into every dark and shattered corner of the globe by a core of young Ivy League graduates trained to preserve democracy at home and defend it abroad. Howard Baskerville was long dead by the time Wilson's dream of a new world order climaxed in 1920 with the creation of the League of Nations, the precursor to the United Nations. But he was there, at Princeton, as the seed of that idea put out shoots across the campus. Baskerville spent his first 2 years at Princeton with his nose buried in the Bible, mastering the fields of scriptural exegesis and Christian apologetics required of all those studying for the ministry. During his junior year, however, Baskerville took advantage of the university's revamped elective system to enroll in two courses taught by Wilson himself, one on jurisprudence, the other on constitutional government. The two men, both of them preachers' sons, both of them compelled to follow suit, ought to have gotten along swimmingly. They both had deep southern roots. Howard's great-great-grandfather, John Coleman, owned a sprawling plantation with a large number of slaves. His grandfather, William Baskerville, was a member of the Confederate Congress from Virginia. And his great-uncle, George Baskerville Douglas, was a surgeon for the Confederate Army who fought alongside the Georgia Regulars at Bull Run. He was captured by Union forces on Easter Sunday, 1865, and paroled soon after the war's end. With so much of his family tree having sprouted from Confederate soil, it's fair to wonder whether Baskerville shared his mentor's prejudice toward black people. The answer is difficult to know. Howard Baskerville was a white man in America at a time in which the scars of the Civil War could still be seen in the burn lines left behind by Sherman in the South. He lived in a state in which the only people of color had been forcibly removed. He attended a university where black students were not welcomed. How did he feel about all this? Was he even aware of the inequity? Probably not. The only thing that can be said with certainty is that no one who knew Howard Baskerville ever described him as a bigot. Like Wilson, Baskerville became a passionate debater at Princeton. He won general honors in debating as a freshman and placed third in a university-wide oratorical contest his junior year. He was awarded the prestigious Francis Biddle Sophomore Prize, given to the student who wrote the best essay on English or American literature, neither of which were Baskerville's chosen field of study. By his own admission, he spent between 8 and 9 hours a day studying. He would go on to graduate cum laude. Always a serious, studious boy, he refused to join any of the upper-class eating clubs. These were Princeton's version of fraternities, which Wilson detested as a waste of valuable time and which he tried yet failed to get rid of during his tenure as university president. Princeton's newly established preceptorial system was meant to encourage students to seek out mentors from the faculty, and it is not difficult to imagine why Baskerville would have chosen Wilson. Not only were the two men aligned in interest and temperament, they were both devout Presbyterians. Wilson's piety and the role of religion in shaping his political views are matters too often neglected in his biography. "My life would not be worth living if it were not for the driving power of religion," Wilson once confessed to a friend. It was his faith in God, his fealty to the Presbyterian Church, and his unshakable confidence in Christian ethics that underlay most of the political assumptions that drove him into government. "If I did not believe that the moral judgment would be the last and final judgment in the minds of men, as well as at the tribunal of God," Wilson wrote, "I could not believe in popular government." The primary purpose of religion, in Wilson's view, was to draw the believer toward public service. Politics was no mere civic duty, it was a religious obligation. Political involvement was all about translating principle into social action. And because for Wilson, the principles that strengthened and sustained American democracy were derived not from men, but from God, quote, "individual salvation is national salvation," he never tired of saying, they could not possibly be reserved for Americans. They must be applied to all peoples in all parts of the world, regardless of creed, culture, or nationality. They must be planted in the native soils of Europe and Asia, Africa, and the Middle East. And who better to do the planting than the pious Princeton graduate, whom Wilson had spent the entirety of his educational career carefully cultivating? It is noteworthy how often God-fearing men have been forward in those revolutions which have vindicated rights, Wilson would have reminded Baskerville in his lectures on constitutional government. And then, lest he miss the point, revolution was not to be distinguished from duty in Princeton. The fusing of politics and piety, the belief that our obligations to each other are indistinguishable from our obligation to God, the conviction that popular sovereignty is a divine mandate over all lands at all times, These are the ideas that Baskerville would have picked up from his two courses with Woodrow Wilson. They would ignite the religious and intellectual passions of the young man, setting him on a course he could scarcely have envisioned. By the time Baskerville returned to Princeton for his senior year, his mind had been made up. Despite enormous pressure from his church and his family to enter seminary immediately after graduation, Baskerville decided to take 3 years off his studies to heed the call of his Lord and go out and make disciples of all nations. Nations that, as his mentor Wilson had taught him, all men should fight to make free. He penned an impassioned letter to the Presbyterian Board of Foreign Missions in New York, declaring his intention to, quote, spend my life in the foreign field, and inquiring whether the church could use him in any of the mission schools. Asked in the formal application where he wanted to be placed, he wrote China or Japan, and then, almost as an afterthought, he added, or Persia, in small print, just above the typewritten text. Baskerville did not really want to go to Persia. His missionary application makes it clear that he felt called by God to preach the gospel in the Far East. In a separate letter to the missions board, he wrote that while he'd be willing to go wherever, quote, it will count for the most for the observance of Christ's kingdom, after much prayer and discernment, he had concluded that his life can be used to the best advantage in China. It's possible he'd read the colorful missionary dispatches being sent home from long-established missions in China and Japan, boasting of the spectacular successes the faithful were experiencing among the noble savages of the Far East. One church reports a net increase for the year of 200%, read a dispatch from northern China. All the schools are crowded, while the demand for Christian education is growing. Training classes for members in which the Bible and Christian doctrine are taught are in demand. The dispatches sent from Tokyo spoke of the striking similarity in climate between the islands of Japan and the British Isles. Japan may be called the Great Britain of the East, read a report to the missions board. The skies are clear and beautiful, and nature clothes itself in its brightest robes of green. It is a land of fruits and flowers, and its hills are stored with the choicest minerals. Compare these reports with the missionary dispatches sent from Persia. Probably nowhere in the world has deceit been more nearly universal, the state of the family and women more degraded, and the ruins of past achievement more manifest than in Persia, wrote Francis B. Packard, a physician and Presbyterian missionary who served in both Kermanshah and Tabriz. Even those missionaries who spent a lifetime toiling in Persia and who, as a result, came to love and admire its culture and people seemed incapable of avoiding the most base stereotypes in their dispatches. The Reverend Justin Perkins, the legendary Presbyterian missionary who almost single-handedly built the West Persia mission, who spent decades living and preaching in Persia, and who buried 6 of his 7 children there, could not help but temper his praise for the Persian people with his own prejudice. The inhabitants of Persia doubtless surpass all other nations in external ease and artificial politeness, and it is with great propriety that they are often styled the French of Asia, Perkins wrote in his memoir. But, sad to tell, Persian politeness is little more than external. Their real character is that of treachery and falsehood in the extreme, and the general degradation of their morals is appalling. Almost all the sins forbidden in the Decalogue are fearfully prevalent among them, and, to those many, add the yet more abominable sin of Sodom. Reading these missionary reports, Baskerville could be forgiven for wanting nothing to do with Persia or its treacherous population. At the same time, he knew that the Presbyterian Church was actively recruiting missionaries to carry the saving knowledge of Christ to the lost sheep of the Middle East. Robert Speer had given numerous speeches at Princeton, lamenting the lack of young Christians willing to confront what the church called the solid wall of Mohammedanism, which, as yet, except in the most general way, has been unyielding. Speer had formed a particularly close connection with the West Persia mission, specifically the American Memorial School, run by the Reverend Samuel Graham Wilson and his wife Annie Ray, in the city of Tabriz, on the northwestern edge of the country. Indeed, he had made it his personal mission to send the school a corps of zealous young men and women ready to win the souls of the students who studied there. Baskerville was aware of Spear's obsession with Persia and so was willing to consider a post in Tabriz, should there be no room for him in China or Japan. But he could not hide his disappointment when he received his assignment. Nevertheless, he humbly accepted the commission under one condition. He would commit only to 2 years in Tabriz rather than the standard 3. If at the end of the 2 years he felt he could no longer stay in Persia, he would pay for half his own ticket back to the United States. He would last 1 year and 7 months before being shot in the back, in a bombed-out orchard, in a besieged city, while leading a militia made up of the very same students he had been sent there to teach and, should the opportunity arise, bring to Christ. He was 24 years old. Attached to Baskerville's missionary application is a neatly typed recommendation on Princeton University letterhead. I have known Mr. Baskerville quite well throughout his college course and regard him as in every way a most estimable man, it read. I think, too, that he has developed considerably during his course and that there is every likelihood that he would fill the position of teacher in the school at Tabriz in a very acceptable manner. I sincerely hope that it will be possible to accord him the appointment. The letter is signed Woodrow Wilson, March 20, 1907. When I picture Howard Baskerville in my mind, standing on the prow of a steamship bound for Liverpool or perhaps Glasgow, either destination merely the first leg of a journey that would cover more than 10,000 miles, I like to imagine a copy of that recommendation letter tucked away in the second-hand steamer trunk. There he is, his shoes shit-stained, his brand-new breeches flaked with mud, staring at the flat horizon, wondering what's to come. It is no stretch of the imagination to think of him at that moment repeating to himself Wilson's words about God-fearing men and revolutions. Is it too far a stretch to hear those same words ringing in his ears as he creeps with his students through that ruined orchard in Tabriz, bullets whizzing past his head? Chapter 2. 1,000 Words for Sword. Liverpool was the likeliest port of entry. In 1907, there was not another seaport on this side of the Atlantic that could compete with its 7-mile stretch of stone-built docks. When Hervin Melville first came here with a crew of harpooners aboard the whaling ship St. Lawrence, he compared Liverpool's chain of granite-rimmed docks to the pyramids of Egypt, so grand and mighty were the structures. Of course, unlike those idle towers of stone, Liverpool's piers and floating roadways were bustling with life. Two of the largest and most lucrative shipping companies in the world, the White Star Line and the Cunard Line, were headquartered here. It's likely the ship Baskerville boarded in New York was launched on the very shores he now slowly approached. Standing on deck, he could look out over the gray dawn and see black smoke rising from the shipyards, the wooden hulls of long abandoned ships splayed along the banks like the fossils of some great leviathan. Baskerville's ship would have berthed at one of the South End docks, perhaps Prince's or Albert or Queen's. Prince's dock was the one most frequented by steamships arriving from America. From there, he could walk to Riverside Station and board a train directly to London. But why not stay in Liverpool, just for a day or two? He could sleep in one of the evangelical boarding houses that Melville wrote about, where missionaries found temporary shelter before heading out into the field. He could take high tea on the waterfront, or shop for souvenirs in the elegant lamp-lit boutiques on Lord Street. After all, he was about to cross an entire continent by train, all the way to Moscow. And this on the eve of a war that would kill 20 million people in ways no human had yet imagined. Europe, at the time of Baskerville's arrival, was, in the indelible words of Barbara Tuchman, a heap of swords piled as delicately as jackstraws. One could not be pulled out without removing the others. Half a century of carefully crafted charters and treaties had created a complex web of alliances that bound together the fates of nearly every European nation. None could go to war without dragging the others along. It was a shaky balance, to be sure, but it had maintained a measure of peace across the continent. There hadn't been a large-scale war in Europe since Napoleon's Armée du Nord shattered against a wall of Anglo-Allied forces at Waterloo a century earlier. Back then, soldiers fought each other across short distances, often face-to-face. Napoleon's feared Grand Battery involved rolling 8-inch howitzers to the front and concentrating their firepower on the center of the enemy's line so that the French cavalry could rush through the breach swinging swords. Napoleon's infantry carried flintlock muskets tipped with bayonets that could, in the best of circumstances, fire 3 volleys a minute at an effective distance of about 100 yards, so long as the muzzle was reloaded after each shot. In the intervening century, war had become mechanized. 6 British soldiers manning a single Vickers machine gun firing 500 rounds a minute could have sliced through the entirety of Napoleon's fighting force in a matter of minutes. 100 men in a trench could ward off 1,000 on the battlefield. Cavalry charges were obsolete, swords worn mostly for show. Baskerville could have purchased a rusty bayonet blade for a few shillings in any one of the antique shops on Liverpool's Lord Street. And yet, despite all this, the prospect of a continent-wide war seemed somehow inevitable. Signs of the impending conflict could be felt across Europe. It was a high-frequency pitch lodged in the ear. You couldn't tell where it was coming from, but it was impossible to ignore. And it was only getting louder. If this war breaks out, then its duration and its end will be unforeseeable, warned the Prussian Field Marshal Helmut von Moltke in a speech to the German Reichstag. Woe to him who sets Europe alight and first throws the match into the powder barrel. The match would be thrown in June 1914 by a 19-year-old Serbian nationalist named Gavrilo Princip, who happened to be standing across the northern end of Latin Bridge in Sarajevo, when an open-air motor car bearing Archduke Franz Ferdinand and his wife took a wrong turn and stopped directly in front of him. Princip pulled out his pistol and lit the powder barrel. Princip wanted nothing more than to put an end to Austro-Hungarian rule over Bosnia. He ended up pulling the first sword in the heap. The Archduke's assassination would lead to the Austro-Hungarian invasion of Serbia. The Austro-Hungarian invasion would awaken the lumbering Russian beast, which had pledged Serbia's safety. Russian mobilization would force Germany's hand, which would then spur France into action. France would inevitably drag the United Kingdom behind it, and once the British joined the fray, the United States would not be far behind, not with Woodrow Wilson at the helm. We desire no conquest, no dominion, no material compensation for the sacrifices we shall freely make, Wilson would tell Congress in April 1917, urging a declaration of war against Germany. We are but one of the champions of the rights of mankind. We shall be satisfied when those rights have been made as secure as the faith and freedom of the nations can make them. No doubt Baskerville could feel the tension building across the continent, but at this moment in 1907, he had more immediate concerns. He was still thousands of miles from his final destination. Before him lay an arduous journey by train, carriage, caravan, and saddle. There were plagues to avert, bandits to outrun. Traveling this close to the end of the stifling summer months meant unending days beneath a merciless sun, followed by nights so cold it froze the marrow. And all of this was before he even arrived in Persia, the thought of which was already setting him on edge. He had been reading about the turmoil taking place in that unfamiliar land. It was in all the papers. "Persia has a parliament," shouted the London Independent. "Merchants and mullahs compelled the Shah to grant reforms," cheered the New York Times. After 2 long years of strikes and street protests, a band of young revolutionaries, backed by business and religious groups, had forced the bloated monarch of Persia, Muzaffar ad-Din Shah, to accept a constitution, establishing the rule of law and severely limiting his unchecked powers. The Persian Constitutional Revolution, as it would come to be known, was the first of its kind in any Muslim-majority state. Its fundamental goal was to marry traditional Islamic principles with modern concepts such as individual rights and popular sovereignty to create a truly indigenous democratic movement. While the revolutionaries lifted some of their language and ideas from Europe and the United States, the movement itself was firmly grounded in a century or more of Persian political thought and promoted by an amalgam of dissident intellectuals, popular preachers, and political activists. Their efforts had resulted not only in a constitution guaranteeing basic rights and freedoms for all Persians, it also led to the creation of an independent parliament called the National Consultative Assembly, with free elections and the clear separation of powers. Persia was now technically a constitutional monarchy, the Middle Eastern equivalent of the nation upon which Baskerville had just stepped foot. Muzaffar ed-Din Shah had signed the Persian constitution into law on December 31, 1906. 3 days later, he died in his bed. The throne was now in the hands of Muzaffar's tyrannical 35-year-old son, Muhammad Ali. A pompous, pudgy young man with a ridiculous mustache who enjoyed playing military dress-up, Muhammad Ali Shah was, in the words of one American observer, the most perverted, cowardly, and vice-ridden monster that had disgraced the throne of Persia in many generations. The new Shah was incensed with his father for making his God-given authority suddenly contingent upon the will of the people. From the moment he took the crown in January of 1907, he had been looking for ways to undermine the constitution he had sworn to uphold. Thus far, however, he had been unable to seriously challenge the new constitutional order. It had only been about 8 months since his ascension to the throne, but it seemed as though the democratic experiment in Persia was working. By an almost bloodless revolution, the centuries-old absolutism of the Persian monarchs had been legally modified by constitutional forms, wrote Morgan Schuster, the American official hired by the National Consultative Assembly to clean up the financial mess left behind by a succession of debauched shahs who had steadily sold off bits of the country to pay for their extravagances. What was even more important, Schuster continued, the people had learned something of their real power and were more determined than ever to save their nation from the straight road to disintegration and decay along which it had been for generations skillfully piloted by its hereditary rulers. The constitutional revolution was cheered by the liberal elite across Europe. In England, the eminent scholar and Persophile E.G. Brown became one of its most vocal champions. In his many speeches, articles, and books, Brown documented the growing demand among the Persian people for freedom and democratic rights. Through his contacts in country, he received a steady stream of letters updating him on the daily struggle against the Shah, letters he would translate and publish in journals and newspapers across Europe. Brown grew hoarse trying to convince the British government to throw its support behind Persia's constitutionalists, yet his calls fell on deaf ears. And he knew why. Britain considered Persia to be, quote, a backward country, which in the hands of its own people cannot be developed, Brown wrote in the preface of his book, The Persian Revolution of 1905 to 1909. The British government was firm in its belief that, quote, the best thing that can happen is that some European power, whether England or Russia, should step in and develop it, whether its people like it or not. In Brown's telling, the English Parliament viewed the Persian Parliament as little more than a novelty imported from Europe, along with motor cars, gramophones, and other Western innovations. Persian culture, in English eyes, was unfit for constitutional government. The Persian people were like children. They needed a firm hand to guide them, and the Shah provided that. Was he a depraved, self-absorbed tyrant? Yes. But without him, Persia would be in shambles. Besides, the idea of a genuine democracy arising in a place like Persia was laughable. As one sniffy British minister declared, the vast majority of the people were not yet clear whether constitution was something to eat or something to wear. And although this may be something of an exaggeration, it may be confidently asserted that popular interest in the matter ceased when it became clear that it was neither of these. Conventional British bigotry aside, there was something else that motivated Britain's imperial policy toward Persia, and that was its stiff opposition to Russia. Anglo-Russian rivalry over Central Asia had been the primary motif of the 19th century. It would come to be known as the Great Game. And by the time the Constitutional Revolution was in full swing, Persia had become the game's principal staging ground. The Russians had long sought to establish control over northern Persian lands. A century of disastrous wars between the two nations had already stripped Persia of almost all its territories in the Caucasus. But that had only whetted the Russian appetite. Persia must fall entirely under Russian influence, claimed Alexander Izvolsky, the Russian diplomat and advisor to Tsar Nicholas II. Russia demanded unfettered access to the warm waters of the Persian Gulf, which could only be achieved by running a railway line across the length of the country. Yet such talk from St. Petersburg rang alarm bells in London, which had its own plans to control Persia's railway construction in order to maintain Britain's existing claims over the Persian Gulf coast. The great game shifted suddenly, however, when the Germans began planning their own railway line between Baghdad and Berlin. Baghdad itself was no great prize, but its location, a mere 300 miles northwest of the port city of Basra, would allow Germany to more easily access the Persian Gulf, and from there the trade routes to India and the Far East. This, in and of itself, was cause for concern, but what truly worried Britain and Russia was what the Berlin-Baghdad Railway signified, an emerging alliance between the German and Ottoman empires. Despite its stale epithet as the sick man of Europe, the Ottoman Empire was a giant, unignorable force in the region. It controlled all trade throughout the length of its vast empire, from the Austro-Hungarian border to the shores of the Persian Gulf. As the bridge between the Occident and the Orient, its sprawling capital, Constantinople, had become the center of gravity for all economic activity in the Black Sea and the Mediterranean basin. With Europe teetering on the edge of war, there was understandably a mad dash across the continent to curry as much favor as possible with the Ottoman court. And in this race, the Germans had a distinct advantage: the hot-headed emperor, Kaiser Wilhelm II. Wilhelm was unquestionably a boor and a brute, a tin-pot dictator who mistook shouting for commanding. But he was not the fool historians have portrayed him to be. He possessed a quick intellect and an iron-willed resolve in political matters that, in the full light of history, can easily be interpreted as narcissistic pathology, even madness. A traumatic breech birth had left him with a withered arm, which he spent his entire life trying to hide from others, and there is some truth to the refrain that Wilhelm manifested in his disabled body the inferiority complex felt by the entire German Empire. He did, after all, title himself Caesar. However, Wilhelm's instinct with regard to the strategic importance of an alliance with the Ottoman Empire was prescient, to say the least. In 1898, he spent several days as a fawning guest in the court of the Ottoman Sultan, Abdulhamid II. The British and French publicly criticized him for consorting with, quote, the blood-stained monster who had slain all the Armenians. But Wilhelm left Constantinople with both an agreement to extend the German-built Anatolian Railway all the way to Baghdad and the eternal friendship of the Caliph of Islam. Before he returned to Berlin, Wilhelm took a royal tour of the Ottoman realm. In Jerusalem, he donned the gleaming white cloak of a pilgrim and rode a magnificent black charger through the gates of the holy city. In Damascus, he visited the mausoleum of Saladin, where he gave a moving speech about standing on the spot where held sway one of the most chivalrous rulers of all times, who often taught his adversaries the right conception of knighthood. When the trip was over, Wilhelm dubbed himself Haji Wilhelm, the Western protector of Muslims against the infidels. The designation Haji indicates completion of the Hajj pilgrimage in Mecca, which Kaiser Wilhelm II most definitely did not do. Let me assure His Majesty the Sultan and the 300 million Muslims who, in whatever corner of the globe they may live, revere in him their caliph, that the German emperor will ever be their friend. The Kaiser's words sent shockwaves through London and St. Petersburg, both of which held under their colonial rule a rather sizable number of those 300 million Muslims. What exactly was Haji Wilhelm suggesting? Was he attempting to rouse the Mohammedan masses to revolt? All at once, the bickering stopped between the British and Russians over who would control Persia. All that mattered now was coming up with a counterbalance to the rising German-Ottoman alliance. In August of 1907, just as Baskerville was arriving in Liverpool, an agreement was formulated in St. Petersburg, known as the Anglo-Russian Convention, whereby Persia was cleanly divided into two spheres of influence. Russia would control the north, and Britain the south. The full name of the treaty was the Convention between the United Kingdom and Russia relating to Persia, Afghanistan, and Tibet. The agreement allowed each country to exploit freely their allotted share of Persia's natural resources. Of course, their plans for Persia would only work if its bothersome population abandoned its unattainable dreams of democracy once and for all. Persia found out about the Anglo-Russian Convention only after it had been signed. The constitutionalists were understandably in shock. They already loathed the Russian Empire for helping prop up a succession of shahs with hundreds of thousands of rubles in loans that were impossible to repay. But they had assumed Britain would be a natural ally in their struggle against the Shah and felt deeply betrayed by the agreement with Russia. Without foreign pressure, there was little expectation that Muhammad Ali would continue to comply with the new constitutional order. That sentiment was even more pronounced in Tabriz, the city where Muhammad Ali had been born and where he had, as royal tradition dictated, spent the bulk of his time as crown prince. Tabriz had served as the epicenter of the constitutional revolution, and its unruly population was familiar enough with Muhammad Ali's character not to trust him. Some of the younger, more radical revolutionaries there had already begun to arm themselves.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.